ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जायमुदीरयेत् यमुदीरयेत् नष्टप्रायेषु भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तम श्लोके उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः कंत्राश्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 10 चैप्टर 55 एंटाइटल्ड द हिस्ट्री ऑफ प्रद्युम्ना वर्स 2 सैव जातो वैदर्भ्याम वैदर्भ्याम कृष्णवीर्य समुद्भवः वीर्य समुद्भव प्रद्युम्न इति विख्यातः न इति विख्यातः सर्वतो अनवमः पितु सर्वतो अनवमः पितु सैव जातो वैदर्भ्यां सैव जातो वैदर्भ्यां कृष्णवीर्य समुद्भवः वीर्य समुद्भवः प्रद्युम्न इति विख्यातः प्रद्युम्न इति विख्यातः सर्वतो अनवमः पितु अनवमः पितु सैव जातो वैदर्भ्यां सैव जातो वैदर्भ्यां कृष्णवीर्यसमुद्भवः कृष्णवीर्यसमुद्भवः प्रद्युम्न इति विख्यातः प्रद्युम्न इति विख्यातः सर्वतो अनवमः पितु सर्वतो अनवमः पितु सैव जातो वैदर्भ्यां कृष्णवीर्यसमुद्भवः इति विख्यातः सर्वतो नमः पितु सैव जातो वैदर्भ्यां कृष्णवीर्यसमुद्भवः ख्यातः प्रद्युम्न इति विख्यातः सर्वतो नमः पितु Vaishnavis What to what translation? Saha, he, eva, indeed, jataha, taking birth, vaidarbhyam, in the daughter of the king of Vidarbha, in the daughter of the king of Vidarbha, Krishna Virya, from the seed of Lord Krishna. Samudbhavam generated Pradyumna iti thus vikhyataha known sarvataha, in all aspects, anavamaha, not inferior, pituhu, to his father. Translation: he took birth in the womb of Vaidarbhi from the seed of Lord Krishna and received the name Pradyumna. In no respect was he inferior to his father. There's no purport, so we'll read verse 3 also. Tam shambhara kamarupi ritva tokam anirdasham saviditvatmanah shatrur prasyodanvatyagad griham. Translation: the demon Shambhara, who could assume any form he desired, kidnapped the infant before he was even 10 days old. Understanding Pradyumna to be his enemy, Shambhara threw him into the sea and then returned home. Purport: Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti points out that according to the Vishnu Purana, Pradyumna was kidnapped on the 6th day after his birth. Om Jnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupah Kadam Maiham Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamsha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Shri Mate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarine Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gauratvishay Namaha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Rishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Bhyascha Kripasindhu Bhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So today morning, we are discussing from the 10th canto, 55th chapter. This is, as title chapter, The History of Pradyumna. Now, Sanatana Goswami, in his Vaishnav Toshini describes that this is the point in the Bhagavatam, or this chapter, from which the 10th canto stops being chronological. Prior to this, the Bhagavatam has been more or less chronological. That means, if we see first there are the Vrindavan pastimes, then there are the Mathura pastimes, till around the 40th chapter is the Vrindavan pastimes, next 10 chapters are the Mathura pastimes. And then from the 50th chapter, Dwarka is built. From then, there are the Dwarka pastimes. So even when he does a sort of historical reconstruction linearly, and he does that in the Vaishnava Toshani, he describes that actually there are some pastimes also which are not exactly sequential in the first 40 chapters of the Prajalila also. But more or less, they are sequential. But in the later part of the Bhagavatam, when we come to Dwarka Lila, the pastimes are no longer sequential in the way in which they occurred. We'll see, if we see this pastime of Pradyumna, certainly after Krishna is married to Rukmini, then they have a child. That is a natural sequence. But then the Pradyumna's life almost entirely is described over here. And if we look, as we go further towards the end of the 10th canto, There we will see there is a pastime of say Krishna helping Krishna Arjuna kidnapping Krishna's sister Subhadra. So Arjuna help, so that is about, is Krishna helping, so the in the Mahabharata the focus is on Arjuna's kidnapping Subhadra. In the Bhagavatam it is on Krishna's planning how Arjuna kidnaps Subhadra. So if you look at the Sanskrit verses, you know, in every when we write or when we speak, there is a primary doer and then there are assistants to that doer. So if you look at the Mahabharata, the focus is on the Pandava. So Arjuna is the doer over there. Whereas if you look at the Bhagavatam, it is Krishna who is the doer. So it is Krishna who plans that his sister will have a worthy match in Arjuna, and he arranges for that. Now if you see before that, and this is something like the 83rd, 84th chapter, if we look at the linear sequence, before that the Kurukshetra war has already got over. In the, if you go sequentially by the pastimes. Now, in the Kurukshetra war, Abhimanyu was 16 years old. That means Subhadra's marriage must have happened at least 16, 17 years before that. So that pastime comes later. So now, Sanatana Goswami gives the reason for this. He says that as Shukadeva Goswami starts going more and more into description of Krishna's pastime, his ecstasy becomes more and more. And then his katha, it is based not so much on smriti as on spurti. Smriti refers to conscious recollection, whereas spurti refers to spontaneous recollection. Conscious recollection means that, you know, we come in front of the deities and then we try to meditate. Now, this is the same Krishna who manifested 5000 years ago. This is the same Krishna who is existing in the spiritual world. And we try to apply our thoughts in a particular way by which our contemplation can become deeper. So that is smriti, where there is conscious application of thought so that there can be sustained recollection. Whereas spurti is spontaneous recollection. There is no effort. There is just the thoughts start flowing on their own. You know, for us, at least for me, spurti happens with respect to sense gratification. The thoughts spontaneously flow. So actually, spurti is what will happen or what happens to advanced devotees because their love for Krishna is their natural disposition. Now for us, devotion for Krishna is more or less a cultivated habit. We are trying to cultivate attraction for Krishna. Anushilanam. That's why Rupa Goswami, when he defines bhakti, he says it is a cultivation. Anushilanam. So right now we are cultivating that. Whereas Shukadeva Goswami, as he is speaking more and more about Krishna, he's getting so much more excited that rather than a smriti, there is a spurti that is happening. So he is normally speaking, Parikshit Maharaj asks some question and then Shukadeva Goswami gives an answer. And if you look at the start of the 10th canto or the end of the 9th canto, the last chapter of the 9th canto is a summary description of Krishna's pastimes. And then Parikshit Maharaj asks, please describe these pastimes in detail. And that's how the 10th canto begins. So now if we see here in the 10th canto, when he's starting to describe Pradyumna's pastime, he just goes into the detail of that pastime. And in general, in case of Leela, there is fact and there is feeling. So feeling is more important than fact in the case of Leela. But that does not mean fact is falsified. It means fact is subordinated and transcended. I'll give three examples of this before we move forward into this pastime. The most standard example we could give is of in the Chaitanya Leela. We see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw every forest as Vrindavan, every tree, every river as Jamuna, no, every hill as Govardhan. Now, this is from the material point of view a defective perception, because that forest is not Vrindavan, that river is not Jamuna. But when we come to the level of transcendental love, the importance is not on accurate perception, the importance is on devotional connection. How much is a person able to see the connectedness of everything with Krishna? So in the case of Leela, this is the first example. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, is he wrong in perceiving every forest as Vrindavan? No. It is right in a transcendental sense because he's seeing everything connected with Krishna. And it's not factually also wrong, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, although he thought every forest to be Vrindavan, he did not stop at that forest. He went onwards till he came to the actual Vrindavan also. So that means, from the spiritual perspective, the utility of things is not dependent on their factual nature in this world. The utility of things is based on their capacity to connect us with Krishna. That is the primary utility of things. So now, second example of the difference of how fact is subordinated to feeling is in the whole foundation of Krishna Lila itself. When I gave Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's example, that example is of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is also God and it is also his Leela, but it is his recollection of pastimes. It is recollection of the venue of the Lord's pastimes. But now if you go into Krishna Leela, here Yashoda Mai thinks that if I do not feed Krishna, Krishna will starve and fall sick and he may die also. Now, here the fact is, Krishna is the Annadata. He is the person who feeds everyone. And more than that, his body is spiritual, it is imperishable. So, from the factual point of view, it may seem to be wrong, Yashoda Mai is feeling. But from the spiritual point of view, it is an ornament. It is a experience, it is a expression of her great devotion. That she feels that Krishna will not be able to live without me. So feeling is more important than fact in the transcendental realm. So the whole point of Leela is that fact is subordinated. If the fact of Krishna's supremacy were always held at the center, no Leela would be possible. Yashoda Mai would never be able to think of Krishna as her child. And practically the whole Vatsalya Ras Leela would not be possible. Even the Madhuri Ras Leela will be difficult because the gopis will not be able to think of Krishna as a cowherd boy. You think of him as God, and how can they have contrary rasa with God? So the fact is subordinated to feeling in Leela. This is directly with respect to Krishna Leela. Now, coming backwards to us. So one is, when I talk about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is more or less at the level of smriti, of the level of spurti. Spontaneously his thoughts go towards Krishna. Whereas now Krishna is in the, whereas Yashoda Mai is directly in the Leela of Krishna. Now coming back to our level, what is important for us? Is fact more important or is feeling more important? Now, if we see, at the level of tattva, there has to be clear analysis. This is matter and this is spirit. And that tattva, if we don't understand, then we confuse the material and the spiritual. And that is undesirable. So firstly, when at our level, most of our feelings come from the body level. And I'll talk about how those feelings can also be dovetailed. But first, there has to be differentiation between the material and the spiritual. Then, after there's a differentiation between the material and the spiritual, then even if the feelings are having a material origin, they can be spiritualized. Even if the feelings are having a material origin, they can be spiritualized. You know, there can be two extremes where one is that we reject everything as material. The other is we simplistically spiritualize everything. So, rejecting everything as material, that is what the Mayavadis do. They say this whole world is Maya, Brahma Satya Jagan Mithya. And they reject the whole material world in itself. And we have to just go beyond the world. And curiously, in the Abrahamic religions also, although you know, in the Abrahamic religions refers to Christianity, Islam and Judaism, and we have the dharmic religions are Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism. Now, in the Abrahamic religions also, there is to some extent a rejection of matter. Not exactly in the philosophical sense in which it is there in the Vedantic tradition. But now, one of the main reasons why the Abrahamic religions are militantly opposed to deity worship. Militantly opposed. Because actually in the Quran it is said Allah can forgive any sin except the sin of idolatry. They consider that as the only unforgivable sin. And why is there that conception? Because there is a radical divorce of matter and spirit. And they think that matter is so low, matter is so sinful, that it can never come in contact with the absolute. So that is why they have the whole idea that if you conceive of God in any material form, you are minimizing God. So now the difference between these two things is, between these two approaches to the rejection of matter, is that in the Vedantic tradition, there is the understanding of the absolute truth as impersonal. Now normally we associate form and personality together. That means we say that Krishna has form and Krishna is a person. And the impersonalists say that Krishna does not have a form and he is not a person. Now, in the Abrahamic religions, the conception is in between. They consider God to be a person but not having a form. So they consider God to be a person but not having a form. And in that sense, now they ascribe form to matter, and what the nature of God is, they say it is unknowable. So now when Krishna descends to this world, he descends in a particular form. In this verse, the word is used, Krishna Virya Samudbhavaha. Now Virya, it is in a euphemistic sense, the word seed is used to refer to that. So now Pradyumna was born from the seed of Krishna. This naturally raises the question, you know, what is the nature of Krishna's interactions with his devotees? And what is the nature of Krishna's pastimes? Now, when, as I said, the first extreme is to reject everything material. Then the other extreme is to talk of everything artificially as spiritual. When Srila Prabhupada was in his final days, at that time he was very sick. And in his extreme sickness, you know, because of the body practically being on the verge of breaking down, there was some drool coming from his mouth. And some devotees started circulating the idea that because a pure devotee's body is transcendental, even this drool is transcendental. And then Tamal Krishna Maharaj writes this in his TKG diary, where the last year is quite heart-wrenchingly and painstakingly from his point of view of detail in recording, but heart-wrenchingly from when we see how even a great devotee can have a lot of trouble at the bodily level. We see that. So he records this. When Prabhupada was asked this, Prabhupada said, This is nonsense. He said, this is asanapi klesha dasa deha. This body is asan. It is temporary and a klesha. It gives misery. Now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what the devotees thought was, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he would ecstasy, sometimes tears would come out of his eyes. Chaitanya Charan would say, mucus would come out of his nose and drool would come out. And that is considered spiritual. But Prabhupada said, this is not spiritual. So Prabhupada is strong in dismissing that idea. So now, when we say a pure devotee's body is spiritual, we have to understand that there is a difference between spiritual in constitution and spiritual in application. Spiritual in constitution means that something is made of Sachitananda. And spiritual in application means that something is used for spiritual purposes. So even a pure devotee's body will grow old, will get diseased, because in constitution it is not spiritual. In application it is fully spiritual because it is being used for Krishna's service. In contrast with that, Krishna, when he descends in this material world, his body is spiritual in constitution. So Krishna's body is Satchitananda. So the attempt to spiritualize everything, so it leads to several logical paradoxes. So for example, now if we say, okay, Krishna's body is spiritual, then, now we know Krishna's body is spiritual in the sense of constitution. Now what about Krishna's associates? They say, oh, Krishna's associates are also spiritual. Okay, then among Krishna's associates, there are also demons. Now, is the demon's body also spiritual? Now here, if we simplistically try to spiritualize everything, we'll have a problem. We know the demon's previous life is also described, and the demons come there because of certain reactions. Now, there are two different things. There is speciality and there is spirituality. The two are different things. Anybody who participates in Krishna's pastimes is special. Anybody who participates, that the soul had a fortune to be there when Krishna manifested, that is special. But we shouldn't equate special with spiritual. So it's not that everybody who manifests in Krishna's pastimes has a spiritual body. And next thing we'll have to say, Chand Kazi, he was a Muslim. Oh, his Muslim body was also spiritual. And then there are bandits and there are all kinds of people. Are all their bodies spiritual? No. So we cannot simplistically spiritualize everything. Nor can we simplistically reject everything as material. So the important principle here is that actually anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam. So whatever is favorable, we accept it. Whatever is unfavorable, we reject it. Now, when Krishna descends to this world, the verse ajopisanavyayatma, it is a very important verse. 4.6 in the Bhagavad Gita, that is a transition. 4.5, Krishna tells that we have gone through many births, bahuni me vetitani. And 4.7, yada yada hi dharmasya, he says that I come again and again for re-establishing dharma. So in the 4.5, Krishna says that that my memory is not affected, that I remember everything. In 4.7, he says he descends. 4.6, he describes the nature by which he descends. Ajopisana vayatma bhutanam ishvaropisan prakritim swamadhishthaya sambhavamyatmamayaya. So sambhavamyatmamayaya. By my internal potency, I descend. So now, in this world, we have illusion. You know, in America, there is a university where they teach people how to do video, how to do whole movie industry, how to go into that, how to shoot video, and how to direct a movie, how to edit a movie. So it is called the American Institute of Illusion. The American Institute of Illusion. So if you consider the movie industry or the TV industry, it is Maya's Maya. This whole world is Maya, but within that we are creating a further Maya. So it's an illusion within illusion. It's Maya's Maya. But when we talk about Atma Maya, Atma Maya, Krishna says it is his internal energy. So when we talk about illusions, illusion, it's one thing to be in illusion and to identify oneself with the body. But it's in another degree of illusion where I don't even identify myself with the body. When we go into illusion, if you're watching a movie, you know, a hero thinks, I am the hero. And a woman, man who's watching the movie thinks that I am the hero. A woman who's watching the movie, she thinks, I am the heroine. So what is happening? It's one level of further illusion. To misidentify with the body that we have is bad enough. To misidentify with the body that we don't have, that is worse. So that is illusion's illusion. Maya is Maya. But now when we come to Krishna Tattva, the word that is used is Yoga Maya. Atma Maya, Yoga Maya. Now, the word Yoga Maya is, from a logical point of view, it is an oxymoron. Oxymoron is a figure of speech in English where two contradictory words are brought together. For example, it is said suicide is an act of courageous cowardice. Suicide is an act of courageous cowardice. Actually, why? Because, you know, sometimes people may go and lie in front of a train. Of course, now lying in front of a train is an old-fashioned form of suicide. Nowadays, people have more modern ways. But either way, whatever it is, if somebody goes and lies in front of a train and thinks, and that hears the train coming, and then he thinks, maybe next day, come out. Or a person feels, loses nerve. Because, you know, to die or to kill oneself requires courage. But when one is killing oneself, not because of a sense of sacrifice or dedication to a higher cause, but because of frustration with one's life, that is cowardice. So now courageous cowardice is two opposite words. So when two opposite words are brought together, normally it will make no sense. But a figure of speech is when two opposite words are brought together to convey a deeper meaning. So oxymoron is the name for that figure of speech. So Yoga Maya is an oxymoron. Why? Because Maya is that which makes us forget reality. And yoga is that which connects us with reality. So what does yoga maya mean? That something which connects us with reality, something which makes us forget reality. How are the two brought together? So yoga maya is that energy of Krishna which makes us forget reality to connect with a higher reality. Like earlier I said, in Leela, fact is subordinated for feeling. So yoga maya does this subordination. Yoga maya subordinates the fact of Krishna's supremacy to cultivate the feeling of Krishna, say in Yashoda Mai, being my child. So yoga maya is, in that sense, it is a divine illusion. Could say a transcendental illusion, a spiritual illusion, where that illusion is in the service of reality. How is it in the service of reality? Because that illusion is connecting us with Krishna. It is helping us go deeper in our relationship with Krishna. Of course, when we become purified, it will be for us, right? It is for the pure devotees who are having that relationship with Krishna. So yoga maya is what operates in Krishna's pastimes, and yoga maya operates even when Krishna's great devotees are acting. So here, when Shukadev Goswami is going beyond a linear chronological narrative to a sphurti-driven narrative, to a spontaneously recollected narrative, that Sanatana Goswami explains in Vaishnava Toshani, that is according to the will of Krishna for the pleasure of Krishna. So he says this is no dushana, this is a bhushana. Normally if somebody gives a sketchy narrative, like I am editor, so if somebody is writing an article and the linear narrative is messed up, I'll say this needs editing, you have to rewrite it properly. But when the same thing is done by a pure devotee out of smurti, that is a bhushana. That means there the feelings are so forceful that it is not that the linear narrative or the historical sequence is not known, but avashaha purvabhyasena tenaiva riyate avashopisaha jigyasurapi yogasya shabda brahmati vartate. Krishna says that even a yogi who is not yet perfected, but a yogi who has practiced some level of spirituality, then gets deviated. In the next life, that yogi immediately becomes attracted to Krishna. And that attraction is avashaha, helpless. So, that attraction is to the general spiritual or transcendental principles, avashaha. But if that helpless attraction can be there, even for a soul who is still partially conditioned, then for a soul who is completely pure-hearted, there is that forceful attraction of feelings which just drives the thinking and the speaking. So therefore, this is a bhushana, it is not a dushana, it is an ornament, it is not a defect. When he leaves the narrative, leaves the linear narrative for the sake of a spontaneously recollected driven narrative. Now in this particular narrative, when we are talking about facts and feelings, even in Krishna Leela, there is a qualitative difference between Vraja Leela and Dwarka Leela. Now qualitative not in the sense that one is material and the other is spiritual, both are spiritual, but the qualitative difference is in that the intimacy is much more in Krishna Leela in Vraja than it is in Dwarka. Now interestingly, this particular pastime that is happening, it is Krishna's son Pradyumna. In one sense, his life is as adventurous as is his father's life. You know, Krishna, he was born and right from his childhood, you know, Putana came along and she tried to poison him. And after that, Trinavart came and took away. So just as Krishna was abducted by Trinavart, similarly, his son is also abducted, Shambhara. Now, Pradyumna is described over here, Sarvato Anavamahapitu. That is, in all ways, or in no ways, is he inferior to his father. So, here, Pradyumna is There are the four view, Chaturvyuha. There are the four manifestations of the divine. So Vasudeva, Sankarsana, Pradyumna, Aniruddha. Now there is Vyuha and there is Avatar. And there is a difference between the two. Vyuha, there is in the Mahabharata, there are three main sections which are devotional in terms of bhakti. Most of the Mahabharata is Karmakanda. So the bhakti sections are the Bhagavad Gita, the Vishnu Sahasranam, and the Narayaniya. Narayaniya is a section where there are prayers and glorifications of Narayan that are offered, along with an analysis of his tattva. So in the Narayaniya, the concept of the Vyuha is elaborated. So what is the difference between a Vyuha? We talk about Chatur Vyuha. Chatur we know is four. Now Vyuha, that actually refers to a spiritual manifestation, or a manifestation in the spiritual realm. See, avatar is the descent from the spiritual to the material, whereas Vyuha is a manifestation in the spiritual. An expansion of the Lord in the spiritual realm is called as Vyuha. So for example, now we know that Krishna expands as Balram, and Balram manifests as Chaturvyuha, Vasudeva Sankarsana Pradyumna Aniruddha. From Sankarsana there is Narayan, from Narayan there is again a second Chaturvyuha, Vasudeva Sankarsana Pradyumna Aniruddha. Now none of these have anything to do with the material world. They are all Vishnumurtis who are there in the spiritual world. Now Prabhupada also does this differentiation, but Prabhupada was usually more focused on the essential message, not on technical precision. So Prabhupada generically uses the word expansion for referring to a manifestation that is at the same level. That means if a spiritual manifestation of the Lord manifests again in the spiritual realm, that is a expansion. And when there is a manifestation from the spiritual realm to the material realm, that is an incarnation. So Vyuha and Avatar. So Vasudev, Sankarsana, Pradyumna, Aniruddha, they are Vyuha. Whereas when Krishna descends to this world, then that is a avatar. Now the word avatar also is one of the many Sanskrit words that are not translatable. Srila Prabhupada would use the word incarnation to refer to avatar. Now again, I'll go back to the same difference between the Vaishnava understanding of incarnation, the Mayavadi understanding of incarnation, and the Abrahamic or the Christian understanding of incarnation. And then we'll return back to this particular pastime to conclude this class. So the word incarnation is used conventionally, or in terms of English language convention, it is used to refer to Jesus' manifestation in the world. As I told earlier, in the Christian tradition, God is considered to be completely unknowable. And that is the reason they say that Bible does not give any positive description of God, because God cannot be described in words. So then their idea is that if God is unknowable, how will he be lovable? So therefore, God out of his mercy manifested as Jesus. Now for 400 years after Jesus came and went, Christians were confused about who was Jesus. And then in the 4th century, the Catholics at that time, they came together and they made a Nicene Creed. And they said that that is considered to be a foundational document, doctrinal document of Christians. And they said the divinity of Christ is manifested in the humanity of Jesus. Now whatever that means, I will not go into a philosophical analysis of that particular statement. So Christ is considered to be God. So the divinity of Christ is manifested in the humanity of Jesus. So they accepted the fact that when Jesus came, he came as a human being. So he had a material form. You know, when he was crucified, at that time, you know, when the nails were pierced into his body, blood came out of his body. So he had a material body. So that's the sense in which they use the word humanity. But although he had a material body, they have the idea of the Holy Spirit. Now, you know, Srila Prabhupada, he would analyze things at different levels of precision for different levels of audiences. So at one time in a lecture, Srila Prabhupada asked, Prabhupada, what do you think about the Holy Ghost? So Prabhupada replied, all ghosts are unholy. all ghosts are unholy. So now the word ghost, it has a decidedly negative connotation. And what that person wanted to ask was, actually, he was asking a question about the Holy Spirit. So, but he used the word Holy Ghost, and Prabhupada was dismissive about it. He says all ghosts are unholy. Now, in the Christian tradition, they have the idea of the Holy Spirit as a means of connection between the divine and the human. So, that Holy Spirit, which belongs to God, manifested in Jesus. And their idea is that anybody who surrenders to Jesus, that Holy Spirit will manifest through that person also, but not to the same degree. So you can become Jesus-like, but you cannot become Jesus. But the point here is, they use the word incarnation, implying or understanding the fact that Jesus had a material body. But still they consider, because the Holy Spirit had fully manifested in Jesus, so they consider him to be an incarnation. Now, when we use the word incarnation to refer to Krishna's manifestations in this world, it is philosophically problematic. Because the problem is that Krishna does not descend in a material form. Krishna's form is transcendental. Now, the Mayavadis also accept the concept of incarnation. But their idea is that the incarnation is Brahman in contact with matter. So their idea is that Brahman, when it contacts with goodness, then it manifests as the avatars. When Brahman contacts with passion, that manifests as the jiva tattva. So all of us are Brahman in contact with passion. And jada tattva, matter, is Brahman in contact with tamas. So it's Brahman in contact with tamas. So their idea is, any form or personality is manifested when there is contact of Brahman with matter. And now, because of this, their idea is we have to go beyond form to the formless. And form is considered to be a tool to the formless reality. So when they talk about the concept of incarnation, or when the Mayavadis use the word incarnation, from the Mayavad philosophy point of view, it is okay. Because they do consider that there is a contact of matter, contact of spirit with matter that is happening. Now if you look at the word incarnation from the etymological point of view, and now there is the word, there is this central word in it is karna. Now karna is very much related with flesh. Like we have carnivorous animals, you know, those who eat flesh. Or we have carnal desires. Carnal desires refers to desires of the flesh, sexual desires. So incarnation literally means to come in flesh. And that is why we have the word reincarnation. That means to come in flesh again. So incarnation is not a philosophically precise word. Now Srila Prabhupada, when he would use his words, now Prabhupada had two different experiences. Yesterday I had a long meeting with His Holiness Giriraj Maharaj in Juhu. So he was telling how Prabhupada would speak according to levels of people. So, you know, there was one Hindu VHP leader who was quite close to Srila Prabhupada, Sadajivat Lal. So he told Prabhupada one time that, Prabhupada, you know, you pronounce Sanskrit verses with a heavily Bengali accent. So Prabhupada said, what can I do? I have a Bengali body. So Prabhupada said, what can I do? I have a Bengali body. So Prabhupada did not deny his Bengali body and his Bengali nature. But at the same time, the message that he gave was transcendental. So the point which I'm making here is that when a devotee, even an acharya like Srila Prabhupada gives a message, the acharya will use words, or there is the message and there is a medium for the message. So the pronunciation is a medium that we understand. But even the language is a medium. The language is also a medium, and when the language is the medium, the word choices are also a medium. So now, Srila Prabhupada faced a formidable task of giving the message of the Vedic literature to an audience that was radically different from the original audience. The audience of Srila Prabhupada was historically, culturally, linguistically, intellectually, religiously, philosophically, and practically disconnected from the original audience. And it was a huge, huge bridge, a huge, huge ocean that Prabhupada had to scale over. You know, we say Hanuman went across the ocean to Lanka. Now Prabhupada, yes, he went across the ocean also to go to America. But you know, his going across, physically going across the ocean is not as remarkable as his intellectually going across the ocean and making the spiritual message accessible to Americans. Now that is a far greater feat. Otherwise, they explain that wisdom to people who have no knowledge of it. It is so difficult. Now, Purnachandra Maharaj was telling us once that, you know, how deep-rooted is the ignorance of the bodily conception. He said, one time I was giving a class and he said, you are not your body. So one person asked, then whose body am I? So there is no doubt that I am the body. So if I am not my body, then whose body am I? So the level of ignorance is so much that to penetrate a spiritual message in that is extremely difficult. So that Srila Prabhupada did that is itself remarkable. Now, when Srila Prabhupada did that, he, if you see in his translations, normally he does not use any Sanskrit terms in his English. He usually uses English terms. So he quotes a lot of Sanskrit verses. But when he is translating into English, he generally uses he uses English translations for the words. So now Srila Prabhupada is conscious that actually the English words are not precise. But it is like, see, there is a concept which is internal. Concept is intellectual, the term is verbal. So if I have to carry a suitcase, you know, suitcase, if I have to carry, there is a handle for the suitcase, and the handle helps me to carry it. So now, sometimes, you know, some suitcases have handles which are not visible only. Just for the sake of style, the handles merge into the suitcase, sort of, suitcase covering. Now, an unfamiliar person comes around, looks at all around the suitcase, where is the handle for it? So the person doesn't know how to move the suitcase, and just trying, without the handle, trying to move the suitcase is very difficult. So, just as a handle makes a suitcase accessible and movable, similarly, terms are handles for concept. So concept is like the suitcase. Term is the handle for the suitcase. So terms are verbal, concepts are intellectual. Now, if there is a porter, you know, a porter, a coolie is supposed to carry something. Now the suitcase is also of a very strange shape and there is no handle to it. The porter will wonder, how will I lift it, how will I carry it? So, you know, Prabhupada did not give double unfamiliarity to people. The concepts anyway were unfamiliar. So if Prabhupada started using terms also which were unfamiliar, that would be like unfamiliarity squared. And then that would lead to bewilderment squared. So Prabhupada usually kept familiar terms. Now although he had familiar terms, but he imbued those terms with new meanings. Like for example, we use the word deity worship. Now the word deity, if you look at it in English dictionary, now the deity refers basically to divinity. It's equivalent to divinity. So for example, we have forest deities, water deities, rain deity. So it just refers to a particular manifestation of devotee, of divinity associated with a particular place or a particular form. Prabhupada used the word deity, but it's a new meaning to the word deity. What is the meaning? That the materially manifested, not materially manifested in the sense of material, but manifested in matter. The form of the divinity that is manifested in matter, that he called as deity. Now Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur, he used the word Shri Murti. And if you read Gaudiya Math publications, even if they're English publications, he will use the word Shri Murti. Now those who are not so familiar with the philosophical context of the discussions, they often use the word idol. Now the word idol has a very negative connotation, because as I said, idolatry is considered to be a great sin. In fact, you know, it is not just a sin. You know, in the Bible, when a sin is to be condemned, it is compared to idolatry. This sin is as bad as idolatry. So idolatry is like the model sin. You know, it's like the model sin. So that's why to use idol to refer to the sacred manifest, sacred form of the divine, that would be a terrible misrepresentation of reality. So Bhakti Sanskrit Thakur did not use the word idol. He used the word Shrimurti. He sort of refused to, because the word was not translatable, so he just used the Sanskrit also in his English writings. But Prabhupada was writing to a entirely different audience. Just as he infused the word deity with a new meaning. That is, deity refers to the manifestation of the divinity in matter. So like that, Prabhupada used the word incarnation, but he infused it with a new meaning. That is, a manifestation of God who is visible to people at the material level, but who is himself not material. So, if we want to be more precise in terms of English term, then the English terms, we could use the word descent. Avatariti iti avatar, one who descends from the spiritual world to the material world. Now, when Krishna descends to the material world, and this is the last point I will take and I'll conclude this, that if Krishna is spiritual, Krishna's form is spiritual, then how is he visible to everyone else who has materialized? Now, one could say that he's not visible only, but it's not like that. You know, he was visible. And when Krishna was in the court, say he came to the Yudhishthira's assembly in Hastinapur to negotiate for peace, he was visible to everyone. It was not that everyone there were pure devotees. Obviously not. Duryodhana was the model of an anti-devotee. So, definitely not a pure devotee. So, actually, the yoga maya, it has a twofold purpose. When Krishna manifests, what it does is, when Krishna manifests in this world, Atma Maya, Sambhavami Atma Maya, yeah? When he manifests, one is, although Krishna manifests in the material world, Krishna remains uncontaminated. That is what is done by Yoga Maya. But the other thing that is done is, see, normally, spirit is invisible to matter, is inaccessible by matter. Now, the soul is there in the body, but we can't see the soul with material eyes. But Yoga Maya, the second thing that it does is that when Krishna descends to this world, to the material eyes, he appears to be just like one of them. So Krishna remains visible. Now Krishna is not accessible in the sense that people may not understand Krishna to be God. Duryodhana did not understand, accept Krishna to be God even after Krishna showed the Vishwarupa. But he could see Krishna, he could interact with Krishna. So Yoga Maya does these two things. One is, it maintains Krishna's spirituality even when he's in the material realm. Second is, it makes Krishna's spiritual form visible, accessible to those who are in the material realm. So when Krishna Virya Samudbhava it is talked about, we should not think of it simplistically as an act of procreation like it happens in the material world. It is actually, the whole thing happens according to the Yoga Maya's arrangement. And how it precisely happens is something which is achintya for us, because it is inconceivable for us, because the whole concept, first of all, the concept of spirit itself is not conceivable for us. See, Krishna says the Atma itself is achintyoyam. Now the Atma is Anu. If the Atma is achintya, then the Paramatma is so much bigger. He will be so much more achintya. And then when the achintya comes in contact with matter, how exactly it happens, that is very difficult for us to understand. But the broad principle that we understand is the principle of mercy that underlies accessibility. That Krishna descends to this world out of his mercy. How exactly he manifests his mercy is not as important for us as how we can benefit from the mercy. It's like when I go to a doctor, how exactly that medicine is made is not as important as how I am supposed to take the medicine. Now, if I want to become a doctor, that's a different issue. And that will require a big training. And before I can become a doctor, first I have to become from a patient to a healthy person. Then I can think of becoming a doctor. So similarly, if we want to study philosophically, very deeply, how Krishna manifests the material world, yes, our acharyas have written many, many books. And there is exhaustive analysis given also. But the most important thing is, when Krishna makes, although he's spiritual, when he makes himself accessible at the material level, we should focus not on the minutiae of exactly how things happen, but on the principle of mercy by which Krishna makes himself accessible. And that same mercy manifests in the access in his deity form also. And when we benefit from that. When we take darshan of Krishna as a deity, when we hear Krishna at the sound vibration of the holy name, sound vibration of Krishna Katha, then our consciousness gets elevated and then ultimately we return back to Krishna. So I'll quickly summarize. I started by talking about how here, from this chapter onwards, the narrative goes from smriti to smurti, from conscious recollection to spontaneous recollection. And then I discussed elaborately how smurti is not, how this non-chronological narration is not a dushana, it is a bhushana. And in that connection, I discussed how fact is subordinated to feeling. And I gave three examples, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Krishna, and then a pure devotee also, Srila Prabhupada. Then I discussed about these two extremes of rejecting everything as material or simplistically declaring everything as spiritual. So both are extremes which have to be avoided. And in that connection, we discussed about the Mayavadi understanding, the Vaishnav understanding, and the Abrahamic understanding. And the whole subject is complex. How matter and spirit interact, and how matter can be spiritualized, even when it is not spiritual in constitution, that the precision of that is difficult to understand, but the purpose is clear enough. And the purpose is what we should focus on, that is to gain access to Krishna's mercy and to elevate ourselves spiritually. Thank you very much. Grantra Chirimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.